Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us this morning. This is Lisette Condor, a specialist from PromPeru Apparel Department. And in order to start, we are proud to introduce Mrs. Amora Carvajal, Director PromPeru Benelux and Scandinavia. She will be our host in this webinar. Welcome, Amora.
Good morning to everyone. Thank you for this introduction. And this webinar, we will have two special guests. I will make the introduction, a little bit of the general market, how is it going on here in the Netherlands, and afterwards I will introduce you to two special guests. Okay, this is the general overview of what is PromPeru worldwide. The commercial offices of Peru abroad, you can see there that we are there in the Netherlands, and we are in charge of six markets in total. The Benelux markets, which are Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands, of course, and Scandinavia, Denmark, Norway, and Sweden. Okay, what's going on? How is it with the Dutch apparel market? The Dutch textile industry has its origins in the 19th century, when it was strongly promoted by the monarch William II. That was the start, the beginning of the development of textile techniques, quality, and education. Wool industry centers, we have them in Leiden, in Tilburg, linen industry center in Haarlem, and silk industry was very strong in the center of Amsterdam. In the 60s and the 70s, the Dutch textile industry had a big crisis and some big families had to close their businesses due to the competitive new emerging production countries over the diversity production to the Dutch colonies. Gradually, the Dutch spinning, dyeing and woven industry disappeared from the Netherlands. Logistic hub, which is the Netherlands for Europe, brought new international companies to the Netherlands. So in the 60s, Levi's, in the 70s, Steelman and Benetton in the 80s. Thank you. Next. Okay, at the end of the 90s, the same process was repeated by the securing of the production in the colonies, in the Dutch colonies, where the labor force reduced the cost of producing garments. Companies that survived these new decentralization tendencies of production were those that had highly developed specialized techniques and producing an end product of high quality and design. International companies continued to establish themselves in the Netherlands in the 90s, like Scandinavian brands, like IC, Bestseller, H&M. In the 20s as well, in this century, the Zalando, Weekamp, Amazon, Google, Alibaba, Naked, and so on. And we think that during this decade, a lot of Asian brands will get here into this market as well. Nowadays, there's a big commitment regarding sustainability. So Dutch people, Dutch market is very aware about what is sustainability. There are several Dutch brands which have signed the IMBO Convenient Agreement on Sustainability Garments and Textile from Dutch industry. And of course, it's very important that traceability and the sustainability for this market. Textiles in the Netherlands are mainly produced in Asia and the European Union. Okay, so mostly Asia and European Union. Textile importers are around 10 billion, of which 5 of them come from countries outside of the European Union. 4.4 billion come from Asia and almost 600 million from Turkey. Okay, this is what's going on with Peruvian exportations last year. We have Peruvian exportations, a total value of 1.335 million to a total of 117 markets worldwide, of course. Main exportations from Peru to the world goes in garments, of course, textile goes to the States. Afterwards, we have Chile, Brazil, Colombia, Ecuador. So the European Union is not so powerful in this one. But okay, main exportations from Peru to the European Union right now, the Netherlands is ranked in the 8th place. Okay, so first it goes to Italy, it goes afterwards to Germany, to France, to Great Britain, and to Norway as well. Okay, the Netherlands is a center for denim in the world. So it's very, very well known for this, which companies such as G-Star and Jesus Industries at the top. And we also have here, it's going each year in Amsterdam, we have the Global Denim Awards and the Denim Trade Event, Kingpins. We also have here non-Dutch companies. They are very active in the Dutch market, and they represent around half of all garment sales. The fashion industry is characterized by two types of suppliers. Brands can either be Dutch brands or foreign brands. We have Dutch brands like for example, Sandwich, Scotch and Soda, Hema, Costas, Sweet Supply, and so on. And foreign brands that are here as Nike, Tom Hilfiger, Asics, and so on. Okay, this is to have a brief introduction, and that wraps it up for me right now. And I'll pass the one to Charles. And Charles is our special guest. He is a commercial director responsible at Fashion United for 4 years already, and he has 15 years experience in media. He is leading Fashion United into the new era, and he's focused on international collaborations, strategic development, and people of people and products. So, Charles, it's all yours.
Thank you, Amora. I'm sitting here together with my colleague Koen, but Koen is later introduced. Just want to give you a little insight on Fashion United itself. I hope that everybody knows us already. As Fashion United, we are basically the B2B platform in the fashion industry. And we've been doing this for 21 years already. And what we basically do, we communicate everything within the industry. And that's what we do in 35 countries. We do that in 9 languages, and we reach around 1.3 million unique visitors every month. What makes Fashion United unique is basically that we unite the fashion industry, and we basically do that in 4 different ways. The first thing is that we write independent news, and that's not just a thing. We write around 70,000 articles a year. That's all relevant content that basically all professionals in this world working in the fashion industry are looking for. So one of the things is, for instance, that we write about Pima cotton, and that we write about alpaca. And because we write about it, people will actually Google-wise find us and write the right news. So that's how we help governments, how we help industries, how we help single brands like a VF or an Inditex, but also smaller brands like a Denim. And that's basically what we do, and we unite the industry, bring everybody together. So that's the first thing. The second thing is the HR. So we help companies find the right people on our website by putting the vacancies out. That's not per se an interesting thing for you, but if anybody would be searching for a sales agent in the Netherlands, Germany, Italy, or Spain, could be an interesting thing in the end. The last thing, because I already told about the content that we write for certain companies, is the technology part. And I mean, it's a fast changing world. So by connecting and writing the news and bringing people together, we also connect companies by putting everything online and helping them setting up websites, but also setting up, getting their data online by just making an API. In short, basically, we bring your business online by using technology and working together with other technology companies that help the fashion industry as well. To give a general insight, and I think that a couple of things would have been really different if we would have had this seminar, let's say, 3 or 4 months ago. And a couple of things have actually changed. So to give a little insight on COVID-19, I'm tapping now on Belgium and the Netherlands, but the same goes pretty much for Germany and France as well. We went into, we call it an intelligent lockdown. So we basically kept on partially working. And we had to keep the 1.5 meters distance from each other. Now the lockdown is eased down a little bit. Kids are going back to school again. People are going back to work again. There are a couple of rules that we have to wear a mouth mask when we go in public transport, of course. The borders were closed, and the borders are opening at this moment again between Germany, France, Belgium, Netherlands. And that's an important thing. Because when you have the lockdown, basically everybody stops working and things that also buying clothing and et cetera also stops. The shops are open again in the Netherlands. They actually did not completely close. Belgium was closed, is open. Germany was closed, but actually opened the small stores first and then the bigger stores. So I would almost say, well, it's back to normal again, but just with some rules. In the meantime, everybody was really suffering, and the government, to talk about the Netherlands, how the government basically supported everybody is that that all the companies basically got 90% of their wages covered. So everybody kept their staff, and the staff was still working, but they just got paid for the staff by the government. And that was not a loan, it was basically a gift. The same goes for Belgium, and the same goes for Germany. This was a little bit different in France and in Spain. In Spain, for instance, where they said, okay, basically governments pays the people, but the people are not working for the company anymore. But I'm not gonna elaborate too much on that one. So we're basically back to business. And what COVID-19 basically brought in this time is that the world was already changing into a more online world. People are more thinking about omnichannel, marketplaces and social commerce. But it seems like as if this COVID-19 accelerated that process. As you probably know yourself as well, a lot of trade fairs have been canceled. So an alternative for a trade fair is a marketplace. People could not go to a store. So you have a lot of more online stores and social commerce selling stock. The omnichannel next to, of course, as a result after the multi-channel is getting more and more important. Why I'm telling this, because this is a thing for manufacturers and for brands and for to really keep in mind that at this moment, 20% of sales are done through online. And the prediction is that this will actually go up to a 35-40% within 3 years. So there's a thing to it to keep in mind. If you want to sell or produce or want to manufacture, keep in mind, is it an offline or an online partner I'm going to collaborate with? Another thing what's going on, a couple of companies will actually go bankrupt because of this crisis. Because the crisis really still has to hit. We first had a lot of support, and now at a certain time, this support will probably stop within 2 months for Netherlands and in Belgium as well. And this will actually result as well in a money problem. So that could have an effect on the liquidity and buying products where, for instance, just-in-time delivery could be really a thing of the future, which you probably have to adapt to as an organization, as a brand, or as a manufacturer. The other thing what it also brings is that there is more awareness. And the awareness says something about support your locals. And this might sound like, well, hey, we're going to support the local Dutch brands. But of course, if you manufacture for local Dutch brands, they are more supported. This is also supporting companies that are more taking care of their local business themselves and their farms. China has become a liability. Koen will tell more about that one later on. And that also the sustainability and circularity is a thing that people, because they start buying online, is a thing that's more, the world's getting more transparent. And people are, because they're thinking more about important things in the world. And this is, well, a thing where Peru could actually stand out in. For the rest, there's a request for unique things with a high quality. I mean, Pima cotton and alpaca is, of course, well, quality. It's really good of that one, if you compare it to some other manufacturers in the world, of course. And people are also looking for some more one-offs. That could be something more to think about in smaller productions from the Netherlands, for instance, and from Belgium. And the last thing in this is the traveling, because we were always used to go to a seminar. an offline show and trade show. Those will actually come back again, and we all think that is really a good thing. But people are traveling less in the meantime. One, to save money, of course. That's a crisis thing. And the other thing is that people are a little bit afraid of traveling, and this will probably stay for another couple of months, and traveling is getting more and more expensive in that case as well. So there's a thing to also make sure that online, that you're well presented and that you have everything online to bring it to the market. And this is a couple of things that really are cohesive together and are all adapted to each other. So that's that thing. The last slide for me in that case, this is a general insight on the current Benelux market. And we always talk about Benelux. Netherlands is a big market, Belgium is a big market, and Luxembourg is pretty much a smaller market, but this is how we say it, these three countries together. We talk with a lot of companies like Afterpay. Afterpay is basically a paying system which you use and you can pay afterwards, like the name says already, when you buy online. And this basically is about May, but March, June, and July will probably be the same. And this sense says something about the change on the behavior and the on the what people will actually buy less and what they actually will buy more. And there's a thing, if you look at the right top button, the right top, you see fashion. I mean, you see at the left in D that it has decreased and will continue to decrease. Well, tickets, traveling, transport, what we just said already, the home decor, etc. But at the right top, it has increased and will continue increasing. So that's really, really a thing based upon buying behavior from Afterpay. And this is what all other brands say as well. So fashion is in the lift. It was a crisis, and it also brings a lot of new possibilities as well, if you look at this one. So that was my part. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Charles. Now I'll introduce our other special guest, Koen Ellerbeck. He worked 20 years as buyer for several Dutch fashion houses. He started his company, the Men of Orange Consultancy Office, in 2016. And actually, Men of Orange helps factories worldwide to find new customers and helps brands to find trustworthy premium manufacturers. So, Koen, the floor is all yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Peru. Glad that all of you could join this session early morning for you guys. We are here a little bit end of the day. I am asked to give you a little bit insight in the Dutch market and what proper opportunities there might arise or are there for you guys to tap in and to increase your sourcing or your order portfolio into adding customers from the European market. In order to do so, of course, you have to get a little bit insight in how do the Dutch brands think, how do the Dutch brand, the European market work. From history point of view, you in South America are, and you see that also in the figures that Amora has shared already, is that the majority of your export goes to America, which is logical. But if you compare America to Europe, then you see a big difference in basically that Europe is far more fashion driven in their setup than what you find in America, at least as far as we know. And that results also in the fact that across Europe, there are so many different countries, and all those countries have their own fashion industry and brands. So therefore, you find a lot of smaller brands, and you find a lot of orders and collections that are being developed, which result in orders that are of quite a limited quantity. Charles already mentioned a little bit that if you go into that the opportunity for Peru might lie in the higher end section with smaller order quantity. But we have to be, so you as a manufacturer has to be aware that if you want to go to the European market, that you will have some smaller order quantities. Often the majority of the brands are making a range of sales samples and a big collection, because they believe that by offering a lot of opportunities to the customers and a lot of color options, that they can find more customers. It results in a nice order package, a nice development package, and also styles that will really challenge your technical capabilities. But you have to be aware of that, and you have to be ready to do that also. Furthermore, the European market, and if I then look at specifically to the Dutch market and the Dutch brands, we are really a margin focused country. A lot of us develop collections, have in-house designers, have a lot of staff, and the cost of course operating a company in Europe is not easy. It's quite high. Moreover, there are a lot of wholesalers, so a lot of brands are not having their own stores. They are selling to stores, multi-brand stores. So in order to do so, you have to give away a lot of margin, which means that again, the company will be focused on trying to buy as cheap as possible, which is a little bit contradicting to what we see, what we know for about the price levels that are common while doing business in Peru. If we look at then on how is it currently done, and if I look, for instance, in the companies I work with, you see that in 1998, when I started my career, then we were all still focusing on production close to home. So we were in Portugal, we were in Turkey, we went to Egypt. Then we all moved to Asia. So we all went first down in Europe, and then we took a left turn towards Asia, to the big manufacturers, to the low production, low cost production countries. Initially, we all went to Hong Kong and then to China, but slowly, and believe me, my bosses have kicked me around the world into a lot of different countries. Every time that I thought, hey, now I have a margin, we had to jump to another country. So we went from China to Indonesia to Vietnam to India to Cambodia to Myanmar to Bangladesh to Pakistan, and all in all to get the right margin for our brand to survive, so to make the brand successful and earn a lot of money. If we, in that way, the focus on going to South America has not been there too much and is still not there too much. And we have to try to, of course, together to make that happen, because you have a brilliant proposition, and I'll come back to that later. If we look at the reasons, because that's what we are all betting on, because all of you are good suppliers and you are betting on a customer, a brand to change their sourcing strategy going forward, we have to look what is the reasons for a brand to change their current partner. Changing of a partner always comes with a headache. So we have to give them a reason to change. So one option could be that the brand could achieve a better margin. Now, for a better margin, they mostly always go to Asia. Now, due to the coronavirus, you also see, and the dollar-euro rate, you also see that a lot of companies already come back to Europe, and that that Europe is quite competitive again in prices compared to Asia. And the cost of transportation is, of course, higher. And the cost of traveling is, of course, higher. So you see a lot of brands were already looking at Asia. They now look back to Europe again. And one thing, because they want to source closer to home, then what you see, another topic that more and more is getting into trend, that people want to be to build a better world. And building a better world also starts with making clothes of recycled material or organic material, because they want to have an open trail. They want to have a clear sight of what's happening. We, let's face it, in the whole world, we are making too much garments. There's too much apparel. There are too many brands, there are too many factories, and the orders are being increased also in a way, because the brands, the companies want to make a certain profit. That will go on, but you see at least the change is happening a bit towards that we have to be organic, sustainable. So we also have to look into Peru, how to play that sustainability, that organic card going forward. Because it's a new brand, a new customer will see that as a reason to change. If you don't, cannot give a certificate, then they will say, sorry, then I look somewhere else. They have so many factories all over the world to choose for. So we have to be prepared. Then a reason for a lot of customers is that they see a better product in front of them. There, Peru, I'm sure Peru can be very strong, because your resources, your alpaca, your Pima cotton is superior. You can bring a superior product to the market. If we market it well, then definitely there is a big advantage here that you can play to any customer, so that they become very much interested in teaming up with you. Then we made a little bit of a SWOT analyze, you can say it, to look a little bit in where does Peru stand, and where is the strength, where is the weaknesses. If we look at your weaker points at the moment, is Peru is perceived to be more expensive than other countries. If I compare, I have bought polo t-shirts in a lot of different countries, from Portugal to Turkey to Egypt to India to Bangladesh to China to Indonesia, and also we look at Peru, then Peru has by far the nicest product, but also the most expensive product, even though that you are duty free for the European country. It's still, your price is high. So that is perceived for a lot of Dutch brands as a weaker proposition. Then the transport times from Peru to the European harbors is approximately 1 week longer than the average Asian harbor. Which is also perceived, if the product, the lead times, of course, where now, as Charles already said, we are looking more into quicker deliveries in the market, then a longer lead time is not always that positive. Your location, as said earlier, the European brands are used to travel to Europe and left towards Asia. Going right to South of America is not so common. A lot of brands like to travel. They like to see where their product is being made. And I think also traveling to Peru is also beautiful. Charles and I were intending to be with you earlier this year. Unfortunately, we couldn't make it, but still we will. We are delighted to come over as soon as we can again. And we have to, of course, somehow put that in the mind of the European or the Dutch brands, that traveling and sourcing from Peru is brings an advantage, because at this moment they will perceive it as a negative part, because a lot of brands always make buyers make a trip, a round trip. So I was always traveling. Okay, we start in China, then we go to Thailand, then we go to Indonesia, then we go to Bangladesh, then we go to India. And 1 week or 1.5 week later, I have to be home again because I want to see my kids. Sometimes I was away for 2-3 weeks. Adding a country in South America only makes the trip longer. and more expensive, therefore. So it's not the best proposition. The sourcing of secondary materials is obviously in Asia quite common. So in China, you can get all the trims, all the fabrics, everything you want. And all those countries are in that sort connected. Even also the factories specialized in making embroideries, making artworks, are very common and very easy to find in the Asian countries. Even in Europe, it's nowadays also quite easy to get that. Peru still needs to take a step in that part, as far as I know. Then I have a point on the bad publicity that currently happens in the world for alpaca. This is, in my perspective, fact of life. This happens. It's nothing to be afraid of. We have to embrace it. We have to turn it around, make it a strength, and we have to sell that the Peruvian market is looking also is environmental friendly. That you have international activity companies, it always happens. And this time they took you as an example. Next time and before, they already had the Kashmir. They already had the goats. They had the donkeys. They had the cows. This is something that will always come back. I can remember when I was working at Gastra, we were making these beautiful jackets with these big fur collars, and the activists were at our doorstep. Yeah, live with it, deal with it, and make it in the end. The product itself will survive, and we have to promote it in a proper way. The strengths then immediately for Peruvian manufacturers, you are an alternative to Asia. There is, due to the coronavirus, for sure at the moment, there is a negative connotation about Asia. So a lot of brands want to go to Europe. A lot of brands are looking for alternative places to source. Peru can be one of those top places to find customers now. Your country offers premium quality. So Pima cotton alpaca is perceived in the world as top end, soft, bright colors, long fibers, so strong products. We have to use it to your advantage and sell it. And moreover, you, as said earlier, you have a duty-free connection to the European mainland. So that's also a very positive sign compared to a lot of Asian countries that do not have that as yet. Opportunities, be on trend, know the market where you are going to, where you want to establish your new customers. Is it America? Is it Holland? Is it Belgium? Is it France? Pinpoint those customers that you are after and attack them in a way that you bring on-trend items. So invest in making own collections that are matching to the collections that your potential new customers are looking for. Go into the certification. Make sure that your company, although you believe, and I'm sure you all believe, that your company is the nicest factory and the most beautiful factory in the world, and you make the nicest product, you are one out of so many factories. You have to try to get a certification that you have the ticks of what a customer is looking for. Financial opportunities. I think all of us, you brands, we are all suffering from it. I have spent in my career so much time talking to brands, talking to factories about financing. You all know a brand always wants credit and a factory always wants to get his money early because you want to buy your you need to buy your materials and etc. And the brand always wants says, yeah, hey, but I need to before I can sell the goods, before I have my money, it takes months, so I need to have credit from you. So I have been talking to third-party financing companies, and there are many, they're also in your country or working in your country, we have to, if a factory has a proposition to a brand that, listen, guys, you can give, do you want 60 days credit? I give you 90. If you are able to say so, such a thing to a brand, you are already winning, because then they want to work with you, because then they already, oh, tick the box, we have a good finance opportunity. But don't you I assume you cannot do it alone. You have to do it with a third party financing company. The last point in this, I strongly believe in selling Peru as a country. So one factory on its own, currently Peru is not in the minds, not top of mind of a lot of Dutch brands. We can be by creating a complete promotion tour or something about how to put Peru better on the market, on the Dutch market, on the Benelux market. Because I think if we sell the strengths of your country and your products in a proper way, then you can win a lot. And there is really a lot of companies, small, bigger, that will be interested in talking to you and sourcing from Peru. Amora also asked me in to give you maybe as a closure a little bit of tips about how to deal with your current Dutch or European buyers or your American buyers. Buyers are, of course, a rare breed. Buyers are being sent into the plane or on the email with only one goal in mind. We need to get our margin. I had a rule with my boss before: if you do not get your margin, then you do not come home. Simple. The Dutch Holland is a small nation. We are only 17 million people, and we have a big mouth. We are open. We say what we think. We talk a lot. Sorry. Sometimes it also takes too long, but okay. But we take time. We also take time for bargaining, because we like to bargain. We have a history in bargaining. We travel the world. We explore the world, and we exchanged coin all kind of ingredients or things we found in Far East, and we brought it back to our country, and we exchanged it for coin in our market. So we like to bargain. So keep in mind that the Dutch wants to bargain. So never give your best price at the first go. Always keep something behind. And I was used to bargain 3, 4, 5 times if needed on the same article, same price, even if the order was very small, just of the sake of it, because we like to bargain. So be prepared, and you can be trained for that. I can help you. In that point, use of price brackets is also a clever one. So the Dutch always go for the lowest price. But if you from day one say, okay, if you have this quantity, this is the price. If you have this quantity, you have this price. Then you can always fall back to that earlier communication, saying, hey, listen, now I have your order. But listen, in the beginning, we already told you, if the quantity is this, then this is the starting price to start bargaining on, not the already the cheapest price. If you offer your prices, including shipment, to your customer, that is then there's always a little bit of bargaining power again for you, because FOB is till the harbor, and then shipment. If a customer organizes shipment from Holland, they go to their own Dutch logistic company, an expensive company again. 9 out of 10 cases, if you use your own forwarder, it's always cheaper than the shipper in the logistic company in Holland. So if you are clever, always already at the beginning, keep that in mind, and build it into your price, because it gives you a little bit of an advantage in the end. And as said earlier, if you have already the opportunity to offer great payment terms to your customer, then you have them, because they will love you for doing that, because otherwise they will keep on knocking at your door until they get, and they usually a buyer keeps on going until he has what he wants. Otherwise, he goes to your neighbor. That's what it is. For now, we can talk for hours on this, but then I think that's not what we should do today. So we already come to the end where what I say to you would say, focus on your core strength, look what it is, find it out, and sell your product, sell yourself, sell your company, sell your country. Charles?
Yeah, a little addition. Thanks, Koen. A little addition to that one is there's an old saying that says, never waste a good crisis. And the key word in this day is basically that there is a lot of change. And this change actually brings possibilities for Peru. This change also, and we know that, and that's also when Koen and I are collaborating together, we get requests from countries like Uzbekistan, Belarus, Jordania, Tunisia, Egypt, Italy. And I'm constantly on the phone with ministries. I'm on the phone with ambassadors. And basically what they want, they basically want not to waste this good crisis. And they really want to put their own product forward. In my opinion, I do think that I do have a preference for Peru, Pima cotton, and the quality-wise and the sustainability side. And what comes in there is basically the awareness. And that is a super important thing and how what the supply chain looks like. And the awareness is basically collaboration. And I've been working together with Piro Moda, with Amora, and with Monica in a good way. And I think what they're doing in the Netherlands is really great. And I also think that they cannot do it alone, and that you as a manufacturer or a brand cannot do it alone. And that what Piro Moda is doing is a good thing. And I also think it should be taken together more global and really putting the awareness of your brand, Alpaca, Pima Cotton out there. Then the next step is, of course, that you put yourself in the slipstream as a brand. And then you can actually create a preference for certain brands and have the engagement with the target audience, because the audience is now looking for an alternative to the way they were doing it. So this is basically the moment.
Okay, thank you so much, Charles Koen. Thank you so much for sharing with us this useful information. I think that you have like talked a little bit broadly of everything, our weak points, our positive opportunities. I think the weak points, yes, we are expensive. Yes, we are. The transportation time is a little bit longer. And the location, okay, weak points. And that we are the alternative to Asia, and we have, of course, premium quality in alpaca and cotton pima. Everybody knows that Peru has quality. And the opportunities, of course, maybe something interesting you just suggested is to invest making maybe some special collections for the brand we as a company, premium company, want to go. And of course, we need to have great payment terms and something to like close it, that Dutch people, Dutch companies have a history in bargaining. So we always need to go with good prices, and yes, and they always want to go with the lowest price as well. So we need to work on that and maybe like explore opportunities for investments or financial opportunities, you know, for third parties maybe. So I think that was it. Thank you so much. We open the floor for questions. I don't know if there are some questions for Peru, the participants, the audience. Are there questions? Maybe you can write them down in the chat.
Yes, thanks, Amora. Thanks, Charles, and thanks, Coin. We have some questions, and I've already sent to you, Amora. Maybe you can read, because there are questions open to our guests. So it will be interesting for all the participants, because, you know, we are a big industry in garments, and I know this is time to catch these opportunities, no? So
okay, okay. One question is, due to COVID-19, is expected to switch or diversify from China to other sourcing countries? In that case, which ones? And in this context, does Peru have concrete opportunities? And what will be the new requirements or certifications to take into consideration? So two questions. First, which other countries for sourcing? Do we have opportunity? And the other one was, is requirements or certifications to take into consideration?
Okay, let me answer your question, or try to. Definitely, due to COVID-19, the perception about China is changing. Because that's simply how the world works. People are afraid. They say the coronavirus came from China, so no one wants to go to China, even though the coronavirus is now everywhere around the world. Still, a lot of brands will definitely look into other countries. Which countries? They will look in any country that comes up with the right proposition for the product that they are currently sourcing from China. Obviously, a lot of companies take outerwear from China. That doesn't really change, or maybe they will look at countries like Indonesia, Vietnam, to make their outerwear. I'm not really sure that they would be looking at Peru to make the outerwear in the technical level that China currently does it. But definitely, there are also still brands that are looking into buying shirts or buying t-shirts also from China. They will consider, if the proposition is right, again, to look at a different country. It's all, if you have to be there at the right moment with the right proposition at the desk of the brand that you are after. If you approach 20, maybe two or three will be interested to talk further. Today, that changed by the day. Certifications question, as said earlier, the certification that people are after are many. I have an example of a customer that we are currently helping from my office in Holland. He was producing, it's a big street brand in Holland. He was producing in China and selling to one of the big retail stores in Holland, Bijenkorf, a chain store, the most luxurious that we have. And that store has said to the top 20 of their customers, you have to be organic in the next two next years. Otherwise, you will be replaced by another customer. And as such, we moved their production to our GOT certified production partner in Turkey, and now the customer is completely happy. So these kind of things happen. If for instance, the Peruvian manufacturers have a GOT certification that gives an advantage to a regular factory that does not have it. I hope that answers your question.
If I can add a small thing to that answer, is that you have the obvious countries, of course, but we also see a couple of new countries trying to conquer the market. What is an important thing is to not just to wait till they come to you, but you really have to tell the story. It's not that you're per se competing always with China or with Turkey or Belarus or Tunisia, Jordan or whatever. There is a thing if you, and we spoke about that before as well, if you can really tell the whole world, and then I would mean tell the story and write the story and make the story, translate story in 20 countries about basically alpaca if you compare it to Kashmir. Kashmir is basically a good marketing product as well. If you tell about alpaca more frequently in all languages, all countries, put in all kind of media wherever you want, what would then actually happen, that people will actually, instead of buying Kashmir and thinking about Kashmir in that change, would say, okay, I'm going to alpaca. And in that case, Peru is the only country you can actually go through to in that case. So there's a strength. But that's telling the story in every country, not by the way what we're doing now in the Benelux, of course, but this is just worldwide telling the whole story. And they cannot go to another competitive country because you are the only ones who basically have alpaca. There's a strength.
Definitely. Very good suggestion.
Okay, thank you so much. I think that the questions are all answered right now. So Lisette, I don't know if you want to add something.
Yes, I think it is important to have to take these opportunities to be productive and to look at all the insights that Charles and Coin give us now. Thanks, Charles. Thanks, Coin. Thanks, Amora. Very interesting to have this kind of webinars. So we are also organizing more webinars on the following months and weeks, and we will let you know to all the participants here. And I think that's all. Thanks for your time. Thanks for these insights. We have some specific questions. I don't know if there is a time because it is important for the companies. I don't know if our guests could have this time to answer.
No problem. Yeah, we are here.
For us, it's the end of the day, so no appointments today anymore.
Okay. Yeah, because we think that it's important to take advantage of all the background that you could give us. And well, there is one question for Jaime Arambulu, and he mentioned for the future business, do Dutch would need to buy services of production control and quality assurance?
The Dutch buyers and brands are quite common to use either third-party inspections or thorough internal inspections to ensure that the quality of the product that they export and import into Holland is of the proper level as ordered. So quality assurance is obviously a very important thing. You will not find any customer that just say, here's your order, start producing and ship it. Bye-bye. No. They will have demands on, for instance, pilling. They will have demands on rubbing levels. They will have AQL norms of the defects that can be in an order. It's quite strict in the European market that people look into quality. That does. I hope this answers your question. If not, please let me know.
Yes. We have another question from Carmen León. Do you think Peta's video will really affect to retail alpaca sales?
What we know, there's a thing. If I look at the video, you can say, yeah, you can have an opinion about it. Things like this happen everywhere. I'm not going to give my specific opinion on that. But there's a thing. You have a couple of ways of doing it. One, that's an advice for me. I mean, we work in media and we write worldwide for all countries. And that's basically what we call, it's a Chinese way of doing it. Make sure that you actually write more positive things than negative things about it. And that will actually make sure that the PETA video will in the end drop down a little bit. If it would have an effect, partly it could have an effect. But what is happening right now that it is basically targeting one incident, one brand. And what PETA wants to punish the whole country and the alpaca industry for it. And that's ridiculous. And that's what they've been doing with a couple of other parties as well. So yes, it will have an effect. But on the other hand, make sure that especially now worldwide, you start communicating your own story, giving interviews, telling about alpaca, and it will actually disappear because this will just be in people's mind for a short time.
I would love to add here that the volume of alpaca products that being exported and sold in the European or the Dutch market at the moment are not that high. So even if you get a hit due to this PETA action or video, because these kind of things keep on happening every time, the market share that you can gain, I think, is much bigger than the market share that you can lose.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Charles, thank you, Coin. There is one more question, and it is from Ruby Gonzalez, and it is specific about the alpaca coats. Do you think that alpaca coats could have an opportunity in your market?
I just bought an alpaca coat, and I actually wore it last time when I met Monica and Amora, by the way, and I showed it to them. So yes, there is a market to it. But it also depends not only on the materials, but it also depends on the brand. But Koen can actually tell more about that side.
In the end, an alpaca coat can of course be sold and developed in a very premium way. If we can convince the brands that Peru is the market for their premium sourcing, then definitely yes. Then there is a market also for selling coats in our country. Our country is on average in the winter, let's say, going to -5 degrees. And in summer, it can go up to 35. But the majority of the year, people are wearing coats. So yes, we are a country where you can sell coats.
Yep.
Definitely. A lot.
Yeah. And actually, if you look at the Dutch market, but you also see it in the French market and the German market as well, people do tend to spend a lot of money on coats. There's a thing. And we just had a talk before we had the meeting about coats. So there's a thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, I think the time is it's out. Thank you very much for your time. For the participants or the guests, thanks Amora, thanks Cohen, thanks Charn, and we will see you on the next webinar.
Thank you so much again, Lisette, Charles Koen, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very interesting.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Nice day. Bye.